Hello, I'm Enrico Formenti from Université Côte d'Azur in France, and I'm here to present you my talk, which is entitled From Linear to Additive Cellular Automata. And this work was co-authored with Alberto De Nunzio, Dari Greenberg, and Luciano Margara. So let's first talk and define precisely what is a cellular automata. Cellular automaton is a formal model of computation which consists in a set of states, a finite set of states G, a dimension D, which is an integer, and another integer R, which is called the radius, and a local update rule, which is normally noted delta. And what is the idea? The idea is that we have an infinite grid, regular grid, in which we arrange an infinite number of identical finite automata, and each finite automata takes a state from G, and the local update rule is used to update the state of these automata. How? The idea is that you see the local update rule as a lookup table in which you represent some the state of your current considered finite automaton and the state of its neighbors. Okay? So here, for example, I choose D equal to 1 and R equal to 1. So, in fact, practically speaking, what we have that all our automata are arranged on the grid, regular grid, which is Z. And here also, for simplicity and to be able to draw nice pictures, I just choose white and blue states, so two states. Okay. And how to update now, for example, this automaton in on which I have my cursor. So the idea is that I consider it, the state of the automaton itself and the one of its neighbors. Here, neighbors are just two, leftmost and rightmost neighbor. And in fact, the R is set to one, and I take these three states, I go to lookup table and see that it corresponds to this entry of the lookup table. And so I put the new state here on my automaton. Okay? I do this for its right neighbor. Again, I check what is the entry, the corresponding entry in the lookup table of the neighborhood here state, and I see that it corresponds to empty state, so empty state, white state. Then I keep on like this, and I obtain a new photo, which we call configuration of all the states. Okay, if I do this in parallel, then I obtain a new snapshot of the states of all automata on my grid. And a snapshot on all automata on my grid is called configuration. So I can keep on, for example, here, and so on. So it's clear that from this local view of my local update function, I can induce a global behavior. And in fact, this global behavior captured by the global function, which is noted with capital delta, and which is defined in this way. For all possible configurations, for all indexes of my automata in the grid, the new value at that point on the grid is given by the local function applied to the window that I see on the grid at that point. Okay? So I can obtain nice spacetime diagrams. For example, if what is a spacetime diagram is that just simply in an illustration of what is the state and the evolution of the states of my cellular automaton. And the idea is that I start with an initial configuration up here, and then I apply my global function and obtain a new configuration which is just stuck at the bottom of the previous one, and then I apply again the global function and obtain a new configuration, and I stack it on the bottom of the previous one, and so on. So if I apply some specific CA, for example, I can obtain pictures like this. Okay, my initial configuration is here, and then if I apply what we call the shift map, we just shift the content of all cells, one cell to the right, and I obtain, for example, this picture. Okay, and so what is the point? The point is that people would like to be able to decide dynamical properties of this cellular automata, that is, decide the properties of these space-time diagrams. But the point is that there is a general result which says that any non-trivial property is in fact undecidable. So what to do from that is we can try to study subclasses of cellular automata in which maybe some properties are decidable. So in literature, in fact, since many years, there is one class which is studied. It is the class of additive CA. And in our context, in fact, we studied the class of additive CA of finite abelian groups. Why? Because the idea is to take a set of states and put a strong structure on the set of states and hope that the structure of the set of states induces some specific structure on the global rule, and the structure on the global rule hints about decidability of properties. Okay, so in fact, if I put the structure of finite abelian group on G, then we can induce a group structure also on configuration, simply applying the operation of group cell-wise, okay? And so what turns out is that the global update rule is simply a group homomorphism of my group G power Z power D, okay? And this is called additivity property in the context of a cellular automata. But in fact, it is just the property of being a group homomorphism. Okay, so what is known in the with respect to dynamical properties in the world of CA is the following. You see, there are many properties, and here we plotted the relationship between those properties. And in fact, here we have that arrows, double arrows, means that the converse is known to be false and of the relation, okay? While the single arrow means that the property, the converse property is unknown. Okay, so many properties, many relationships, and what happens when we turn from general cellular automata to the known the board of additive cellular automata. Then, as I told you, things simplify. And in fact, we have that, you see, many properties coincide. Okay, so we have a simplified situation. So the idea of using a group structure is in some way interesting. And what we proved in a former paper of us is that, in fact, we can even simplify further when considering finite abelian groups. Okay, and in fact, we have just this very simple, in some sense, situation, okay, in which you see that there are only double arrows and a specific situation here concerning denseness of periodic orbits and surjectivity, okay? In fact, this arrow holds only in dimension one, and it is unknown if it holds for larger dimensions. Okay, so what we did in our paper? In our paper, we just proved the decidability of the properties which are colored in yellow, okay? And there are currently unknown properties, decidability properties, which are positive expansivity and strong transitivity. We simply don't know. Remark that this is also a strange situation because positive expansivity, for example, is a property which holds only for one-dimensional cellular automata. And so, while all other properties are property which holds for any dimension, okay, which can be found in any dimension. Okay, so, in fact, since things are a little bit long, then I just chose to show you how to prove decidability for this property, which is at the bottom left of the diagram, sensitivity to initial conditions. Okay, so let's see how to prove this in the context of cellular automata over finite abelian groups. The idea is to start from linear, what we call linear cellular automata. Linear cellular automata are cellular automata which are considered on a specific group. The group is Z over MZ. So, a very special group, and we say that the local rule is a linear local rule when it is a linear combination of some matrices, okay? And the matrices are taken from the general linear group NG. So, we say that a cellular automaton over Z M over MZ is a linear cellular automaton when it has a linear local rule. Okay, so here, in fact, if you look better, we see that states of finite automata are vector of elements of my group. Okay. Okay. So, what is the idea? The idea is that we can associate two linear cellular automata formal power series, and which is a very handful tool to prove stuff in algebra or similar. And so the idea is that if we start with a group which is Z over MZ, then we can consider Laurent polynomials with coefficient in G, okay, and so a configuration which is simply G power N power Z, so G power n is the state of the automata, and all automata are arranged on the regular grid Z, then I can associate to this initial to each initial configuration a form of power series as follows. It is simply the value of the vector at position I times x power I. So practically speaking, I have a vector of formal power series in which coefficients are given by the coefficients of my configuration. Okay? And then I can also associate a formal power series to the global update rule, which is the following. It is the product between a matrix A and the formal power series representing the configuration. And the matrix A is just a matrix which is a linear combination of the matrices defining the local rule. Okay? So what is the trick? The trick is that for each time t, the formal power series associated to the t time evolution of my cellular automaton, it is simply a power t times the formal power series associated to the initial configuration. And the idea is that I would like to exploit the properties of this matrix A and its powers to say properties on the general behavior of my automaton. Okay? And in fact, it is what it is done. And but we have one more step. So we step by a new concept, Frobenius linear cellular automaton. Frobenius linear cellular automaton are simply linear CA in which the associated formal power series has a special form. In fact, it is a Frobenius matrix and in which the last row is made by Laurent polynomials over G, okay? And the idea is to exploit also here the special form of the matrix to try to induce properties on the automaton, okay? So what we have done in some past paper is to prove that given a linear cellular automaton with an associated formal power series A, you can say that it is sensitive to initial conditions if and only if the cardinality of the set of powers of A, all possible powers of A, is infinite. And this is if only if the automaton is not equicontinuous. So continuity is another global property. Okay, but we are interested in sensitivity to initial condition and its relation with the set of powers of my formal power series A. Second interesting theorem is that sensitivity to initial condition is decidable for Frobenius LCA. Okay? What we have done in this paper is to prove what we call the Big Gun theorem, which is a theorem which is a pure algebra theorem and may be interesting also for its own, which says the following. If we take some commutative K algebra L and two matrices on general linear group NL such that the characteristic polynomials of the two matrices are identical, then the set of powers of A is finite if and only if the set of powers of B is finite. So this is an interesting result which was apparently not known and which required a proof of more than 25 LaTeX pages, and which appeared in the appendix, and of course for lack of room it won't appear in the current version of the paper, and it will be put in the long version of our work. So how to exploit the Big Gun theorem? In this way. In fact, we can prove, thanks to the Big Gun theorem, that sensitivity to initial conditions is decidable for linear CA over GN. And in fact, how this is done? Just choose some linear CA H over G power N. G here is, I recall it is always as before, Z over MZ, and A, let A be its formal power series. Let delta be the Frobenius LCA of the and let its formal power series be B, and let it be such that the characteristic polynomial of B is the same as the characteristic polynomial of A. This can always be done because the characteristic polynomial of Frobenius LCA is it can be computed from it is identical to one of A, and the Frobenius matrix of Frobenius LCA is simply the Frobenius matrix in which the bottom row consists in the elements, in the coefficients, in fact, of the characteristic polynomial. So it can always be constructed. And now we use theorem 2 to say if our Frobenius linear cellular automata is sensitive to initial condition or not, and then this says if the powers of the set of powers of V is finite or not, and the Big Gun theorem says that if it is infinite or not, the set of powers of B, this will determine if it is infinite or not, the set of powers of A. And then we just use proposition 1 on the powers of A to decide if also our initial linear cellular automata was sensible to initial conditions or not. Then we can even lift this property to general additive automata over finite abelian groups, so not the groups just like Z over MZ, but general abelian groups, just by using a lifting trick. We prove for linear CA, and we prove that there is an embedding from an additive CA to a linear CA. And so we prove decidability also for the general case. So, in order to conclude, I provide some perspectives. So the idea is to see what happens to our decidability results when I try to generalize my technique to non-abelian groups. In fact, in our proofs, we exploited in several points that we have abelian groups, and we can use the fundamental theorem for finite abelian groups, which says that each finite abelian group is the product of finite product of specific groups like Z over MZ with different M's. And then we use this to separate the problem into sub-problem and try to solve each one. So when tapping to the non-abelian groups, we have to rebuild this part. And in fact, when I visited Jerko Kari last year, he showed me some constructions, some general construction, which generalize our sensitivity result, for example, to general group, not even abelian, every group. The point is that those constructions have an incredible high complexity, while our proofs just have a polynomial complexity. So can we in some way rework things to use ideas from our proof and turn them into Kari constructions to have better performing decision algorithms? We don't know. And then another idea, another possibility is to use a weaker structure than groups, and for example monoids. This will overcomplexify things, but maybe some results are still true. And finally, in fact, we can use our desolidability results in practical applications. For example, additive CA over finite abelian groups are used in to design some cryptographic protocols. And the idea is to use several linear cellular automaton to design cryptographic primitives, and use the combination of them to produce complex cryptographic functions. But the point is that I must ensure, for example, that some dynamical properties are true for that. For example, sensitivity to initial conditions. And here we have the possibility to decide those properties. And so to declare those protocols robust or not. Thank you for your attention, and that was all for me.